morning and welcome to our act of worship here at St Botolph's this morning. Today is the second Sunday before Advent. And we meet in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We prepare ourselves before the Lord as we come to him, realising the things that we have done that we should not have done, and those things we could have done which we did not. Would you please sit or kneel for our prayers of penitence? Christ calls us to share the heavenly banquet of his love with all the saints in earth and heaven. Knowing our unworthiness and sin, let us ask from him both mercy and forgiveness. We say together, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May God our Father forgive you your sins and bring you to the fellowship of his table with his saints forever. Amen. The collect for today, the second Sunday before Advent. Heavenly Father, whose blessed Son was revealed to destroy the works of the devil and to make us the children of God and heirs of eternal life, grant that we, having this hope, may purify ourselves even as he is pure, that when he shall appear in power and great glory, we may be made like him in his eternal and glorious kingdom, where he is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We now listen to our readings for today.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Concerning the times and seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labour pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness for that day to surprise you like a thief, for you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.
Alleluia.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with 2 talents came also forward, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid. I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you are. Here is what is yours.' But his master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow, and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Here we are, halfway through November, halfway, possibly, hopefully, through another lockdown, and with the clocks turned back so that the nights seem longer and darker, it shouldn't be a surprise if we're experiencing strong hibernatory tendencies. I know I'm waking up later in the morning and I just want to hunker down in the evenings, although in these days of restrictions there's not much chance of doing anything else. Yet as we approach the beginning of the church's year on Advent Sunday, the message that we're hearing in our readings is all about watching, waiting, being awake. Wake up, look out, be alert. Our gospel readings feature parables in which Jesus teaches his listeners about the need to be ready for what is coming, to be open, to be watchful. Last week we heard about the foolish bridesmaids who missed the wedding feast because they had needed at the very last minute to seek oil for their lamps. And today, on the second Sunday before Advent, we have the parable of the servants. The servant, the master, and the talents he shares with them. It's a familiar story. The master is going away and his slaves are given money to steward in his absence. The two slaves who are given the most talents, and it has to be said that in those days a talent was an enormous sum of money, apparently they know what is expected of them. They recognise that in a way they've been set a test and they perform well. They pass the exam and they're rewarded. The man with a single talent seems to have a bit of a history with the master, and he seems to expect that he's actually been set up to fail. Perhaps he doesn't know what to do, or maybe he doesn't bother, but the result is the same. He fails the test and he's punished. I don't know what your reaction is to this parable, but I've always found it quite hard to come to terms with. It seems to set Christianity out as a bit like a heavenly exam system. God has set out his syllabus and shown us what to do, what rules to follow, and what work to achieve. One day he will set the final exam, and those who pass can look forward to good things, while those who fail will face bad things. Do you remember taking exams? The anguish and tension were almost enough to make you forget everything you ever knew and fail before you started. It always seems slightly unfair that at the end of several years' work, success or failure should be judged on the results of a few hours. So to me, this parable is difficult because the idea of passing or failing the spiritual test appears to negate everything that Jesus declared throughout his ministry. Jesus came, he declared, not to call the righteous, but to call sinners. He came to seek sinners, to save the lost, and he opened his arms to prostitutes, tax collectors, children. He knew no barriers, and he broke all taboos. Of course, we know a great deal of his teaching was aimed at the Jewish leaders, particularly the scribes and the Pharisees. He was warning them how dangerous and limiting it is simply to think in terms of keeping the rules, and how complacency is a barrier to understanding. Jesus' listeners at the time of his preaching would have recognised the parable immediately as a story about God and Israel. God was the master, and the slaves represented the people of Israel. The idol slave were the scribes and Pharisees who had hidden away the wonderful news and promises of God's presence among them. Instead of obeying God's command to be a light to the world, they had kept the light for themselves. Now, with the return of God among them in the person of Jesus, they were being called to account. And the threatened destruction of Jerusalem and the temple was to be a just punishment for a servant who had not done his master's will. On another level, Jesus was also warning his own disciples. He knew that he too would soon be going away, and he wanted them to prepare for a long period when he would not be with them physically. He was going to leave them tasks to be undertaken and accomplished. On his return, there would be judgment, certainly, perhaps not of the pass-fail type, but rather a weighing up of their openness and response to God. He wanted them to remain alert and watchful. So what does this parable have to say to us then? Is it about being complacent? Is it about passing a test? Or about the full use of all the talents we've been given? Who are the servants? And if they represent us, which of the servants are we? And what are our talents? In the parable, the talents are monetary, representing financial wealth. But of course, our modern thinking defines them much more as skills, the things which we're particularly good at, the things we do well. They can, of course, also be gifts, the things which have been given to us and for which we feel grateful. This may include money, but it may also include less tangible things like our health, our families, the love we experience. As Christians, we are called to share those talents, those gifts. By and large, we do offer all these things back to God. Our worship here in St. Botolph's Church in normal times is enhanced by the flowers, the music, our lesson readers, those who have a warmly welcoming smile and who enhance our hospitality. Outside, our society benefits from an army of volunteers who offer skills and expertise to improve the lives of the less fortunate in a way that government can never afford to do, and in places where it often fails to recognise a need. But I think this parable is about much more than that. As Christians, our greatest and most precious talent, our most precious gift, is our faith. The gift we have been given of knowing God and of recognising signs of his kingdom in the present. We're being asked, I think, to nurture that and to share it, to recognise the God who is constantly with us, the God who has not gone away at all, to see him in all those we meet, and particularly in those who are outsiders, the weak, the disadvantaged, the elderly and sick, those in trouble and despair. Which servant are we? I suspect the answer to that is we're all three. On good days, we're able to be brave, outgoing, responsive, and faithfully using the talent of faith exactly as Jesus would have us do. Other days we try, but perhaps we have less success. And on our bad days, we're too weighted down with our own concerns to risk anything, and the talent is retired to a safe but hidden corner of our lives. Jesus knew the disciples' strengths and weaknesses very well. He knew they'd have failures, but he empowered them for ultimate success. He knows our strengths and weaknesses too, and he has empowered us to succeed him if we place our trust and hope in him. Through these last weeks before Advent, through the darkness of both COVID and the winter, as we prepare to celebrate his coming, God with us, he wants us to stay awake to all the opportunities he presents us. No dozing in comfort in front of the fire in case we miss something. He asks that our light, our talent, our faith should shine out for all to see. Wait, be watchful, stay awake. God is here among us. Amen.
we affirm our faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
Let us pray. Let us pray for the Church and for the world. Let us thank God for his goodness. Almighty Lord, open our eyes to your presence, open our ears to your call, open our heart to your love, that we may give ourselves to you and work to your praise and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Lord, we pray for you to strengthen our bishops, Donald and John. We ask your blessing on Jackie, our vicar, and her family. Lord, you know their needs better than we do. Please protect them and support them and fill them with your Holy Spirit, so they can best fulfill their work for you in this world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for the lasting peace in the heart of all, peace in our land, peace among the nations, and peace among the religion. O Lord, give peace in our homes and peace in all our dealings. Make us peacemakers in our communities and enlighten us to inspire others by our example and be strengthened to carry on even in the hardest times. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, maker of heaven and earth, we remember before you all who are homeless and can find no place to rest. We pray for street children and children in care. We pray for all who are lonely and feel neglected. We also pray for those who spend these days in hospital or ill at home. We name in our heart any people we know in special needs. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we give thanks that you have opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. We remember all who have entered into the joy and peace in the glory of your kingdom. We hold them in our hearts. Hear us as we remember those who have died. May they rejoice in your kingdom. Unite us together again in one family to sing your praise forever and ever. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Rejoicing in the fellowship of St. Botolph and all your saints, we commend ourselves and all people to your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We are fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God through Christ our Lord, who came and preached peace to those who were far off and those who were near. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
As the grain once scattered in the fields and the grapes once dispersed on the hillside are now reunited on this table in bread and wine, so, Lord, may your whole church soon be gathered together from the corners of the earth into your kingdom.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, We proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Botolph and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. As we look for the coming of the kingdom, let us pray as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, in this holy sacrament, you give substance to our hope. Bring us at the last to that fullness of life for which we long, through Jesus Christ our Saviour.
Amen.
Amen. A reminder to you all that the church building is open twice each week at the moment, on a Sunday morning from 10:30 to 11:30 and again on Friday from 10:30 to 11:30, and this is for private prayer. All are welcome to come into the church and spend some time here and maybe light a candle, spend some time with the Lord in this beautiful building. Although we all know that we can pray wherever we are and we will be heard. The blessing. Christ, our King, make you faithful and strong to do his will, that you may reign with him in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Following all God's saints in the ways of holiness and truth, go in peace to love and serve our Lord and King. In the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.